You see, businesses don't exist to give jobs. They exist to fulfill a purpose. God didn't create you so you would have something to do. God created you because He has something to do, of which you and I have a privilege of being a part. And that's the wonder of being created, coming into this world.
Forever, yeah. Come on, never forget.
Never forget what you done for me.
Always remember that you died for me. Nobody ever done what you done for me. Cause she fights for me, sacrifice for me.
Never forget what you done for me.
Always remember that you died for me. Nobody ever done what you done for me. Cause she fights for me, sacrifice for me.
He was the time when tears won't stop raining from my eyes. When you found me, it was December. I can still remember when you found my life.
You feed me, yeah. You clothe me, protect me, you care for me, and you love me. I can never pay you back.
You
feed me, you clothe me, protect me, you care for me. Can never pay you back.
I hit my back against the wall with no way out.
You delivered me.
Once was lost, but I'm found. Never be the same. No, 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 no.
Cause you're a friend to me.
Only friend when I needed one, yeah.
My comforter.
Come on, what could I do without you?
You are so good to me.
This is what you did for me.
You made me somebody.
You made me somebody. I don't know, but you don't know to be mad.
You clothe me, protect me.
Come on,
you
come on,
and love me.
I can never pay you back. Your grace is free of charge.
For me.
I always remember,
nobody
knows
what you done for me. Cause she fights for me, sacrifice for me.
I'll never forget,
what you done for me.
Always
remember that you died for me. Cause nobody ever done what you done for me.
She fights
for me, sacrifice for me.
I'll never forget,
what you done for me.
I always remember
that you died for me.
Nobody ever done what you done for me.
No, 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 no,
no. Always remember
that you died for
nobody
me.
Nobody ever
died. Nobody ever done what you died for me. Cause she fights for me, sacrifice for me.
Ooh, ooh, yeah. You have changed my life forever. And it's all by grace, Lord, it's all by grace. Oh, yeah.
On today's program, Charles Price begins the series, Living in the Will of God. Rather than asking, what is the will of God for my life? We should be asking, how does the role and purpose of my life conform to the general will of God? This week is entitled, Seeing the Big Picture.
Now, if you got your Bible, I'm going to read to you from Psalm 139. I'm not going to read the whole of this psalm. I'm going to read a big section of it. The psalms come to us, of course, as complete units in themselves. They're not chapter divisions. They're separate poems written by various different people. This is a psalm of David. And I want to read to you from verse 1, where he writes, O Lord, you have searched me. And you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. You hem me in, behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. And that's where I'm going to stop reading, but keep your Bible open there. I want to spend a few weeks talking to you about living in the will of God. A big question that many folks have is, does God have a plan for my life? And if he does, how do I know what it is? I was listening to CBC Radio one morning this last week, and I heard a conversation that was going on where somebody said, if there is a God, he's like a poker dealer who deals out a hand, and then it's your job to make the best of the cards that he gives you. Some have been dealt a good hand, and some have a poor hand, but it's up to you to make the best of what he's given to you. And sometimes life seems that way to a lot of people. Life seems to be fairly random, unfair. It's the luck of the draw that some person has this and some person has that, and somebody was born in this environment, somebody was born in that environment. And what you got to learn to do is to play your hand well. But something inside us tells us that's not enough. Jeremiah in the Old Testament expressed a universal sense when he wrote in Jeremiah 10:23, I know, O Lord, that a man's life is not his own. It's not for man to direct his steps. In other words, he says, you know, we can't make sense of this life on our own. We're not sufficient to give life meaning and purpose on our own. And most people know they need some kind of help from outside of themselves. That's one of the reasons why 80% of newspapers in North America every day carry an astrological chart. In a survey done a couple of years ago now, up at York University here in Toronto, it was a survey amongst first-year students, and 45% of the students said they read their stars, and over 20% had made a decision in the past year based on their horoscope. And about a decade ago, an older survey said that 55% of North Americans believe in astrology, and an even more disturbing poll showed that 10% of, quote, evangelical Christians, unquote, consult their horoscope. Well, the Bible doesn't have much to say about astrology, but where it does mention it about three times is with scorn and with rebuke. And in Deuteronomy 17, it says, bowing down to the sun, the moon, and the stars is a detestable thing. It's described in that passage as evil in the eyes of the Lord. So how 10% of evangelicals are doing that, I haven't a clue. But then what is an evangelical these days? It seems to be a, you know, a smorgasbord of stuff. But the point is, and the reason why I mention that, is because something deep down inside us longs to be known, longs to be significant, and longs to be guided. And we need to know, and we want to know, that our lives are, have greater significance than simply playing the hand that we've been dealt and hoping you play it well enough. And if you play it well enough, you'll have a good funeral at the end of it all. And that's it. Not a very exciting life, is it? There's a guy in the first service this morning who came here for the first time, and he said, I want to give you my pen because it's got my phone number on it. And he gave me this pen. I hadn't got my glass on at the time. So when I got upstairs where my office is just now, I looked at the pen and it says family funeral home. So I'm not sure why I need his number. But you know, we're down here for a short while. Your life, says the book of James, is like a vapor. It appears for a short while and then disappears. You get up in the morning, there's a mist and it's here. The sun comes out, it's gone. Didn't notice this go. The book of James says life is like that. Between your birth and your death, which is not a very long period in the grand scale of history. Is anybody actually interested enough to give my life meaning and purpose? That's why I read these verses in Psalm 139. I love the way it starts. Oh Lord, you have searched me. You know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. And we read much of the psalm just now. And if you read it carefully, you'll discover that in those verses, there are 81 personal pronouns. As far as I can see, that is 81 times. It's I and you, you, me, you, I, you know me, you love me, you care for me, you listen to me, you guide me, you direct me. And when I feel I'm hidden, you know exactly where I am. When it's dark, you can see through the darkness, and you have a plan for me. And before I was born, you knew me. I mean, this psalm is all about the fact you, me, you, me, you, me, you, me. God is actually interested in you. He knows you. And as one of those verses says, that when I was woven together, your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. In other words, before my body was even formed, you knew me in advance. I was not a surprise. Now, some of us may think that we were a mistake. Our parents might have told us we were a mistake. You might feel like a mistake. You might look like a mistake. But nobody is. The day you were born, God didn't look from heaven and say, where did that one come from? Oh, man, we got enough already. What are we going to do with that one? The day you were born, the day I was born, God looked from heaven. And if he said anything, he said, here he comes, here she comes, right on schedule. Where's the book? Here's the book, page one. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them even came to be. That doesn't mean, as we're going to see in a few weeks' time, that we're locked into some predetermined program out of which we cannot break. We can't break away from that. Of course we can. But it means that when you were born, you were created and known by God. You are known before you were born, and your life has significance. Your life has a purpose. Your life is one that God will lead and guide and direct you in. And it's this which gives life its significance. And what I want to do this morning, because we'll cover this over a number of weeks, is take a few moments to clear a little bit of ground so we lay the foundation for how we want to talk about this. The big question that many of us want to know the answer to is, how do I know the will of God for my life? That is a question that's being asked all the time. I've just spent 3 days out in Saskatchewan, these last couple of days, at a Bible college there. It was their missions conference, about 800 students. It was a privilege to speak to them twice a day and engage in a lot of conversation with these young men and women. And this is a big issue for some of them. What is the will of God for my life? Well, of course, it's a good question. But it's not actually the best question. We need to be very careful about the questions that we ask, because there is a saying that says if you ask the wrong question, you'll probably get the wrong answer. And if the first question is, what is the will of God for my life? What we'll be looking for as an answer to that question is some kind of spiritual GPS, global positioning system. You know, that's a receiver that gets information from about 32 orbiting satellites, and you stick it in your car. We have a GPS system in our car. My wife bought it for me. She always buys me presents that she needs. And you ask, who gets lost out of you two? But it's great. It's tuned to a British female voice, so I'm used to being told what to do by a British female voice anyway. Except this is a fairly static voice. It doesn't carry much emotion, and you punch in the address, and it tells you exactly what to do. You punch in the address, you start the car, it'll say, go to the end of the road, turn left. Turn right at the next lights. Go for 6 kilometers. Turn left. Recalculating. Recalculating. When it's safe, do a U-turn. It always says when it's safe. You know, we would like that. We'd like God's will for our lives to be some kind of stick up your spiritual antenna, and there's a sort of GPS, and so you get up in the morning and go to the university and study this subject. See that girl over there? Marry her. Go and get this job. Live at that address. Live happily ever after. Amen. And that's what we look for. God, just show me what to do. Tell me where to go. Make life make sense for me. We'd be content with that. That's why the question, what is the will of God for my life, is not actually the first question. It is a valid question, but the first question is, what is the will of God, period? Not what is the will of God for me, what is the will of God for God? What is the big picture of what God is doing in the world, of which I, as an individual, can have a part? Because we'll only ever discover the personal will of God for me, and it'll only ever make sense within my understanding of the general will of God in our world, of which I can have a part. Because my purpose in life, if it's to be valid, must be an expression of His purpose in our world. My agenda to be valid must be an expression of God's agenda. My goals to be valid must be an expression of His goals. So the first question is, what is it that God is doing that predates me and will post-date me? What is the big picture? If you're going to be interviewed for a job, the first question is not what you want me to do. The first question is, what is the nature of the business? And having understood the nature of the business, then what you want me to do will make sense in the light of my understanding of the big role and purpose of the business. My individual role and purpose will be significant as it's a fulfillment of that bigger role and purpose. You see, businesses don't exist to give jobs. They exist to fulfill a purpose. God didn't create you so you would have something to do. God created you because He has something to do, of which you and I have a privilege of being a part. And that's the wonder of being created and coming into this world. And God has plans for your life, and God has plans for my life that are part of the bigger picture. And sometimes my own life's role may seem to be very insignificant. What is the point of this? But it's a key role in the big picture of what God is doing. There's a saying that we hear from time to time, God has a wonderful plan for your life. What is true is God has a wonderful plan. Now, for you, the role may not be that wonderful, but it furthers his wonderful plan. And sometimes we play a role in God's overall purposes, and we say, what is the reason for this? And we don't actually have answers to that until one day when we know all that there is to know. We will know what the New Testament says about the will of God. It is good. It is perfect. Therefore, it's acceptable. So the first question is, what is the big picture? What is God doing in the world? And sometimes we narrow our lives down to the little picture of me and my role, and it doesn't always make sense, and sometimes it seems very frustrating. There are various accounts of the story I'm going to tell you, but I found out this week in doing a little research that the origin of this story is in the Rule of Saint Benedict, a document written back in the 6th century. Saint Benedict built the Abbey of Monte Cassino in Italy, which is still there today. And Benedict tells the story in his Rule of St. Benedict that a group of men were working on the building site in Monte Cassino. And somebody came to one of them and said, what are you doing? And he said, well, I'm a bricklayer and I'm building a wall. Then he went to somebody else and said, what are you doing? And he said, I'm a carpenter and I'm carving some beams. He went to another one and said, what are you doing? Well, I'm a sander and I'm sanding down this block of marble. He went to another guy who was digging dirt out of the ground. He said, what are you doing? He said, I'm building a cathedral. Now, it was true. The one guy was a bricklayer and the other guy was a carpenter and the other guy was a sander and this other guy was probably a digger. But when their focus was, I'm building a wall, I'm cutting some wood, you can be pretty sure in due course that'll get tedious and tiring and you'll look for something else to do. But when you have the vision of the other guy, I'm building a cathedral, I'm not just building a wall, I'm not just carving a beam, there's something big I'm part of here. That gives meaning and purpose and excitement to the little bit that you are doing. And so it is with life, that there's a big picture. And what I want to do this morning from this psalm is just lay a foundation of two things that are fundamental to what we're going to learn about the will of God as we look into the scripture, and then in the course of time, the will of God for me. And how do I find that out? And how do I find my place in that? And the two things I want to say to you this morning are, number one, and I'll explain what I mean by these things and why these are important. Number one, we are objects of God's love. First of all, now why do I say that? Psalm 139, which I just read to you, is a great psalm. As I said, 81 personal pronouns. You know me, you see me, you discern me, you're familiar with me, and all that kind of thing. But if you look at the very last verse of Psalm 138, which precedes it, it says there, the Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands. So he starts that statement by saying, the Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. He finishes it, don't abandon the work of your hands. In the middle of it, he says, your love endures forever. In other words, your purpose for my life, your works of which I am to be a part, are a consequence of your love for me. Now, why is it important to say that? Because a lot of Christians think of themselves as simply being pawns on God's chessboard. And if I'm talking about the will of God, and if you take what I've said so far about you have a part in the big picture, maybe you think, well, that's all my part is. I'm just a pawn on the chessboard and I get moved around till eventually I get taken and I'm out of the story. And it's cold and I'm used. But that is not what the scripture teaches us. Psalm 139 is written out of a sense of God's love and his expression of that love. He created me. He knows me. He's familiar with me. He's present with me. He loves me. Those are all there in this psalm. And it's in that context, he says, all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be, there in verse 16. We're not just pawns on his chessboard. We are the objects of his love. And one of the important things that we as Christian people need to know is that we are loved, not just because it's a doctrinal bullet point on our creed, God loves me, but we know it because we experience it. And as Romans 5 verse 5 says about a genuine Christian, God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. That's the Holy Spirit's job. That within our hearts, we know because we know because we know. Now, I know we don't live on feelings. Feelings are part of us, but they're not reliable. My son is learning to fly out of Manitoba. And I saw him briefly yesterday because when I came back from Saskatchewan, I flew through Winnipeg and had a couple of hours with him. And he's flying every day at the moment and he's loving it. And he was telling me that one of the first things you have to learn in flying is not to trust what you feel. Because he says, sometimes you feel you're moving in a certain direction. You've got to drive and fly by the instruments. The instruments are what you trust, not how you feel or what you think you can see. And we didn't talk about this because I don't preach to him. But he probably has thought about it. That's such a good illustration of the Christian life. You keep your eyes on the instruments, keep your eyes on the Word of God, keep your eyes on the Lord himself. But, you know, sometimes we don't feel loved. Sometimes we feel distance. We feel dejected. I talked to somebody after the first service who's going through a very hard time of feeling God is distant. That's a feeling. It's not a fact. It's not a fact. Because why she came to tell me that was because reading these verses this morning, these verses went right into her heart. You know me. You know when I sit. You know when I rise. I don't feel it. But you're loved. And I've a number of times said to somebody, why don't you go home, open your verse at Romans 5, verse 5, God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us, and just ask him to make that a real experience in your own heart, that you know that he loves you, because you know that he loves you, because you know. Why? Because he tells you, and you sense it, and you're overwhelmed with it. Don't live off a feeling. But there are times and there are moments when God meets you in that way and you know it. You see, our relationship with God is not one when he keeps explaining what he's doing. In this psalm, down in verse 11, he says, if I say, surely the darkness will hide me, the light become night around me. In other words, he says, I go into this dark tunnel, this dark experience, when everything around me seems to be dark and even the light has become dark. He says, when I'm in that situation, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like day, for darkness is as light to you. I feel in the dark. God sees me and works in me totally in the light. He knows what he's doing. There are dark times. We'll talk about those. We'll talk about some of the big mysteries of life. Why do these things happen? Why does that happen? And so I love the fact that this psalm paints a beautiful picture of the fact that God knows me and he loves me. And to be known doesn't mean he knows your name. He knows you. He knows you. And he loves you. You need to know that as you look. What is the meaning of my life? What is the purpose of my life? What am I supposed to be doing? We're at different stages in life. Some of you are looking back over decades maybe of your life and you're tempted to think, oh boy, did I really live it well? Because you say, I don't know if I can see anything. It tells me I did. But if your life has been surrendered to the Lord Jesus Christ, you may have been through dark times. You may look back with dark times. We'll talk about this on another occasion. But what is dark to you is light to Him. He loves you. He knows what He's doing. That's the first thing. We're the objects of His love. The second thing is we are subjects of His lordship. Let me explain this. Objects of His love, subjects of His lordship. I was born in the United Kingdom. And because I was born in the United Kingdom, I am not a citizen of the United Kingdom because it doesn't have any citizens. United Kingdom has subjects. Citizens owe their allegiance to a state. Subjects own their allegiance to a monarch. And if a person becomes an immigrant into the United Kingdom, or somebody joins the armed forces, or they become a member of parliament, they have to swear an allegiance, and their allegiance is to Her Majesty the Queen, not to the country. It's a kingdom or a queendom. Canada is kind of caught in the middle here because it kind of technically is a constitutional monarchy. And we have the same queen as it happens here, but she's an absentee queen. And once in a while waves across the Atlantic and we kind of wave back, mind your own business, and we get on with it. So Canadians are called citizens. They're really caught in the middle of it all. But you're not a republic. We're not a republic here. And when Jesus talked about the work of God, He didn't say, the republic of God is near. He said, the kingdom of God is near. That means that anybody who's going to be part of that is going to become a subject. Kings only have subjects. They don't have peers. And fundamental to our understanding of the will of God must be this recognition that when we come into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, we're coming into a relationship with a king, with a lord, with a master, whatever term you want to use, all those words are used of Christ in the New Testament. As Jesus said in Matthew 7:21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. It's not about getting the language right. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven, that is the person who brings their lives in submission to His kingship and His lordship. And this, of course, is at the heart of the gospel. It's not an extra to the gospel. It is the gospel. Romans 14, verse 9 says, for this reason, Christ died and returned to life that He might be Lord of both the dead and the living. That's why He died and was raised, to be Lord. That is that our lives might be brought under new management. That involves a surrender to Him. And that is fundamental to the Christian life. Now, when somebody comes to Jesus Christ and says, I like a lot of the benefits of the Christian life. I'd like to become a recipient of those benefits. I want to have my sins forgiven. I want to go to heaven when I die. I'd like to have my prayers answered. I'd like to have some guidance through life. But I don't want you to master me. I don't want you to be in charge of every part of my life. I don't want you knocking on my bedroom door. I don't want you checking my bank account and how I'm spending my money. But I would like you to guide me and direct me. You know what that person receives from Christ? They receive nothing. How do we know that? Because people tried that in the New Testament. There are several examples. One is the story of a man we call the rich young ruler. Do you remember that story? You can read it in Mark chapter 10, but it's in Matthew and Luke. And I won't read it to you. I'll just remind you of the story that Jesus was coming out of Jericho when a man came running up to them. He was with a group of folks and he fell on his knees and face in the front of Jesus and said, good master, what must I do to receive eternal life? Now, that's a brilliant question. I'm sure the disciples got very excited. Wow, this is fantastic. Here's this guy on his knees asking the right question. What must I do to receive eternal life? And Jesus said to him, what about the commandments? The man said, which? So Jesus began to recite them. He got through about five or six, when the man interrupted and said, all these I have kept since I was a boy. Well, I don't believe him, and I'm sure Jesus didn't, but that's what he said. And then Jesus said, there's one thing you lack. You're a rich man. Go sell your possessions, give them away to the poor, and then come and follow me. Now, why in the world did Jesus make an issue of this man's wealth when here's a man asking for eternal life? What's the connection? Is it wrong to be rich? The answer is no, of course it's not wrong to be rich. The Bible warns it's dangerous, but it's not wrong. But what the scripture says is this: no one can serve two masters. You'll love the one and you'll hate the other. You cannot serve God and money, some translations say, God and mammon, others say, God and materialism, others say. And what the Lord was saying was this: you want to receive eternal life, that it means having a new master in your life. But there's a problem. You've already got a master. Get rid of that master. Then come and follow me. And to show that his diagnosis was accurate, it says, the man went away sad because he was very rich. In other words, he said, oh, okay, I'm not willing to go that far. And he went away sad. And what did Jesus do? Did he run after him and say, hey, sorry, I didn't mean to frighten you like that. Hey, come back and let's negotiate about this. I mean, it was brilliant, the question you asked me there. You'd like to have eternal life? You want to go to heaven or what? I'll write down what you want. Okay, that's great. Would you like to have your sins forgiven? You haven't got many of them. You say, well, I don't believe you fully, but you've got a few teeny weeny ones, surely. Come on. Okay, I'll forgive you those. Right, that's good. Now, listen, you're a rich man. I've got some ideas what we could do with your money. Would you like my ideas for that, or have you got your own? You've got your own, okay? You want to keep your own? Yeah, right. Now, you're single, is that right? Would you like me to decide who you should marry, or you want to do that? Beg your pardon? What's her name, did you say? Well, she mightn't have a name, because I may want you to stay single. What I want to know is, do you want my will or yours? You can handle that, okay? I mean, if after a few years you're getting nowhere, you can come back and pray and we'll see if we can help. But I'll leave that to you. Now, when I ascend to my Father, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to fill my disciples. Would you be willing to be filled with the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost? What do you say? As long as nothing funny happens? Okay, all right. All right, well, we'll keep it low key for you, you know, just keep your hands in your pocket and keep your mouth shut and things. Now, but look at this list. All you really want is to have your sins forgiven, go to heaven when you die. Oh, that is all you want. Okay. Well, look, let me tell you something. That's not going to be the greatest Christian life, but it's a good starting point. So welcome into the kingdom. And at least if a camel sits on you, you know where you're going. And if you get a bit frustrated with this later, you can always come back and get rededicated and that kind of thing. But God bless you. Welcome to the family. Is that what Jesus said to him? Of course it wasn't. I fear sometimes that's kind of popular evangelicalism today, though. Just come on your own terms. Just nod your head and wink in his direction. You know, like you're at an auction and they're saying 20, 20, 20, 20, 20, 25, 25, 25, 25, 25. And somebody gets, you know, flicks a finger like that and 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 35, 30. You know, and you come to Christ, you know, you just have, I didn't mean that, but okay, I'm a Christian now. Oh. You know, we make it almost like that. No, said Jesus. If you want to receive eternal life, you must understand that is not something you'll get when you die. It is the presence of God in you now to reign, to take over your life. You see, what we know about this man is that he was basically interested in his own agenda. We only know three things about the rich young ruler. And the three things are that he was rich and he was young and he was a ruler. That's why we call him the rich young ruler. It kind of sums him up. When you think about it, those three things are all very attractive. It's very attractive to be rich. I wouldn't know, but I've thought about it. it's very attractive to be young, I remember. And, you know, most of us, we like the idea of being young. You know, when you're about 12, and somebody says, how old are you? I'm 12, that's a good age. 13, 13, 14, 14. When I'm 15, what they usually say is, I'm 16 next year. And they try to get a bit older. You're 16, I'm 17 next year. And then you become 18, that's a good age. 19, 20, 21's a good age. 22, 21, a bit. 23, 24, 25, I'm just in my early 20s, you know. We try to be younger. And from 25 till about 75, you know, we try to act as though we're younger. We paint ourselves to look a bit younger. We love it. If you want to make somebody really feel good, you know, you tell them that they look younger than they really are. And people love that. Until you get to 79. And then you say, how old are you? And they say, I'm 80 next year. They can't wait then. And then they're 81. They're not going to say I'm 81. They say I'm in my 82nd year, you know. And they get to 90, and boy, I'm in my 10th decade. And then we love it. But from 25 to 75, you know, we love to be young because it's a young people's world, and it's always been that way. This man was young. He was also a ruler. That meant he told people what to do, and they did it. That must have been nice. I wouldn't know. My wife doesn't cooperate. But he probably sat down one day, I'm rich, I'm young, I'm a ruler, life's going for me well, but there's a problem, and the problem is one day I've got to die. And when I die, I won't be young, rich anymore, somebody else will have my monies. I won't be young anymore, I won't be a ruler anymore, somebody else will have my authority delegated to them. If only I could have a life that would never end. Boy, that would be fantastic. And somebody said to him one day, you ever heard about Jesus of Nazareth? No, who's he? He's a preacher. Oh, I don't listen to preachers. But do you know what he's preaching about? No. He's preaching about eternal life. Eternal life? Man, that's the very thing that I need. Well, you're in luck. He's leaving Jericho this morning. Catch him. And as they were leaving Jericho, look down the road. There's a cloud of dust. The man running up the road with all his work comes to the back of the crowd, elbows his way through, falls on the ground in front of Jesus. Good master, what must I do to receive eternal life? In other words, Jesus, I've got a problem. You've got the answer. Give me the answer. And Jesus said, no. I'm sorry. I don't give it on your terms. If you want to receive eternal life, it involves receiving a new master. And if you and I want to know the will of God for our lives, it begins with bringing our lives in submission and surrender. That doesn't mean that everything's hunky-dory in your Christian life. Of course it doesn't. Surrendering to Christ is that disposition that says, Lord, I want you to have your way in my life. And we struggle and battle. We fall in and out with him. And we don't always understand what that means. But as we grow in understanding, we'll grow in our surrender to him. But it doesn't mean, you know, that you're a perfect Christian. There is no such thing. When I got married, I had to say certain things to Hillary. One of the things I had to say was this, forsaking all others, I take you only unto me. And what that meant was, what I meant by that was that I will never again look at a girl the way I look at you. I'll never develop a relationship with a girl that I have with you. I'll never go on a date with a girl. I'll only ever go on a date with you. And I made that commitment that day. That's what was meant 29 years ago. And I've lived by that commitment for the last 29 years. But that didn't make me a perfect husband overnight. That took a month. Now, of course, I'm not a perfect husband. I'm a rotten husband. I keep going away. But the thing is this. I have a disposition towards Hillary that says, you have a place in my life that nobody else shares. And you say, Lord Jesus Christ, I know I'm going to flip and flop around the place like we all do, but I want you to know that you are the one I love, the one I trust, the one to whom I submit myself. And yes, the old nature will fight against the spirit. The scripture tells us that is part and parcel of life. But the heart of it is that all to Jesus I surrender. And I know, as many of you know, that you go through issues and struggles and you You fail and you sin, but you come back and say, I'm sorry. You're my Lord. We're the objects of his love, and we're the subjects of his lordship. Donald Gray Barnhouse was a famous preacher from Philadelphia. He wrote a book called The Way Up Is Down. What he meant by that was this. If you want to grow in the Christian life, the way up is down. Matthew 16:25 says, whoever wants to save his life will lose it. Whoever wants to lose his life will find it. In other words, if you're willing to give your life away to Jesus Christ, if you're willing to lose your life, that's the way down. You'll find life in all its fullness. It'll take you up. The way up is down. On the other hand, the way down is up. If you want to keep life, if you want life to be all about you, and keep your life and keep your agendas, you will lose it. The way up is down, the way down is up, said Barnhouse. Matthew 23 says, whoever exalts himself will be humbled. Whoever humbles himself will be exalted. What's the way up? Down. Humble yourself. You'll be exalted. But you exalt yourself, you're going to be humbled. And that's why to find life in its fullness is to actually let go of life. And the lordship of Christ is to let go of trying to control everything and try to predict everything and try and be in charge of everything and build all the protections that we like to build around ourselves and say, Lord Jesus, I surrender everything to you and thank you that in the center of your will is the safest place on earth. Is the most satisfying place on earth where my old self and my old ego has been crucified with you. I'm released to be what I was created to be. So if you want the will of God for your life, it's a lot deeper than a spiritual GPS. It's a life that surrendered. We are the objects of his love. Therefore, we can trust him because he loves us. We can trust him. We are the subjects of his lordship, and therefore we obey him. And these two things, obedience and trust, are the two essential ingredients in living the Christian life. We obey what he says. We trust who he is. And of course, the third, and these are the three ingredients, is that we love him. But I have said before that obedience and trust like two wings on an airplane. Which is the most important wing on the airplane? The left one or the right one? You need two wings to fly. If you try to fly the Christian life simply on the basis of obedience, you'll become legalistic. All be about keeping the rules. If you try to fly just on the basis of trust, God loves me, I'm just going to trust him, you'll end up in some unhealthy, sentimental mysticism. But if you obey what he says, because he's Lord, and you trust who he is, because he loves, that's dynamism. You'll fly. And the will of God does not come to us as an appendage, an add-on, sidebar to the Christian life. You want his will, okay, just tell me what to do. That's great. This is a good plan you got here. It flows out of a relationship that responds to his love, that knows that we're loved, we're known, we're seen, all the things that are listed here in Psalm 139, and responds in obedience that before I was born, all the days ordained for me were written in your book, and I'm surrendering to your book that you as Lord direct my paths. It's not a poker hand, make the best of it. You are created for a purpose, and God Himself will work that purpose out, and all the circumstances that come to mold us, as we'll talk about in later weeks, all part of equipping us and making us for this purpose that God has for you, that gives your life meaning and direction and deep satisfaction. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you this morning. We're not just little dots on a little planet that's part of a galaxy, that's part of a vast universe, and we're just insignificant accidents, freaks of nature, here today, gone tomorrow, forgotten with the passage of time. But your word tells us before we were ever born, you knew us. Before we were formed in our mother's wombs, you knew us. And all the days ordained for us were written in your book. And we thank you so much for the purpose, the meaning that gives to our lives. And we want to be people, Lord Jesus, who trust you because we know that you love us. And all that you do is in love. Even the things that are darkness to us and painful to us, that you're molding us. And we want to be those who trust you because you love us and obey you because your plans are good and perfect and acceptable. Make this real in our hearts and in our experience, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in again next week for another message from Charles Price. His ways are not our ways. In life, we constantly have to make important decisions. So how do we discern the will of God for our lives?
The first question needs to be, what is the will of God? Period. If we ask as our first question, what is the will of God for my life? The focal point, the central point is me. But if the question is, what is the will of God? The starting point and the focal point is, what is God doing that is bigger than me, of which I may be a part?
There is no set formula for discerning the will of God, but the Bible does give us some guidelines. This 9-part series, Living in the Will of God, will point you in the right direction and help you avoid some of the pitfalls. Write to Living Truth to order by mail or call Canada +1 416 222 3341, extension 113, or contact us through our website, livingtruth.ca.
I love you, I need you, I want.
please come and dwell in my heart. Lord Jesus, please come and dwell in my heart.
Sprinkle me with your blood, and I'll be as white as snow in my heart, Lord. Create me a good home. I want to please you every day, yes. Teach me how to work in your holy ways more than ever before. I need you, my Lord. I need you, my Lord.
Come and dwell in my heart, in my heart, Lord Jesus. Please come and dwell in my
heart. I
love you.
I need you.
I need you.
I need you to forgive me,
Lord. Please come and dwell in my heart, in my heart, Lord Jesus. Please come and dwell.
Come and dwell inside my heart. Oh yes, Lord, I need you, I need you, I need you, I need you. Oh yeah.